What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the previous video of the series, we dove into the fundamentals of basic authentication in Spring Boot, understanding how systems verify user identities. Today, we're stepping up our game with a deep dive into OAuth 2. The auth in OAuth 2 stands for authorization, and before we get started, let's highlight the difference between authentication and authorization. You see, the authorization flow contains authentication as its first step, and that's why people are often confused between the two. Authorization is typically based on roles, permissions, or policies associated with the authenticated identity. It involves defining rules that dictate what actions or specific resources can be accessed by the authenticated user. Basic authentication is a simple and straightforward method where the client sends a username and password with each request, similarly to what we did in the previous video. However, OAuth 2 is an industry standard protocol for authorization that provides a more secure and flexible way to handle authentication and authorization. OAuth 2 is considered more secure because it doesn't involve sending user credentials with each request. Instead, it relies on tokens that can have a limited scope and duration. So which protocol should we pick? Well, we should use basic authentication when the application has low security requirements, the communication channel is secured via HTTPS, and when we have a trusted environment and want a simple solution. On the other hand, use OAuth 2 if security is top priority, if we need to grant fine-grained access to resources, and if we want to enable third-party applications to access our resources securely. Okay, now that we know the difference between the two, let's delve into OAuth 2 and start by adding the Maven dependencies in front of us to our Spring Boot project. In the last video, as soon as we added the basic authentication dependency, a username and password were being generated for us and authentication was enabled in our application. That won't happen with OAuth 2. We can't benefit from it out of the box, as now we must provide our application with a provider. You see, in OAuth 2, an identity provider is a system that issues authentication tokens to an application. It's a service responsible for authenticating users and providing information about them, such as user attributes and permissions. An OAuth 2 provider typically includes the following two main components: an authorization server, responsible for authenticating the user and obtaining their consent for the requested permissions. It issues access tokens to the client's application. And the resource server, which hosts and protects the user's resources. It validates access tokens, allowing it to accept or respond to protected resource requests using these tokens. In our example, we will not spend hours reinventing the wheel. Instead, we will make use of Google's authorization server. Now, this authorization server, or any other server for that matter, can't start issuing tokens to everybody. Any application that needs to benefit from these servers must register itself within that authorization server. To do that, we'll need a client ID and a client secret. These are our application's credentials to authenticate itself within this server and allow us to benefit from the service it provides. Okay, to integrate Google's provider in our current application, all we need to do is add the following configuration to our application.yaml or application.properties configuration file. And as mentioned, the last missing piece are the client ID and client secret. To obtain these from Google, we'll need to navigate to the URL in front of us, which is also provided in the description below. After signing in, the first step would be to create a project, set up a consent screen for our application, and finally publish the app. Feel free to pause the video and follow along with the pictures. Okay, once this is done, go ahead and attempt to generate an OAuth client ID and client secret. Now, take these credentials and copy-paste them into our application, then run it. If we attempt to navigate to the Swagger endpoint we've been making use of throughout this series, we will automatically be redirected to the famous Google login page. After picking an account and granting consent, we are then redirected to the Swagger page requested. Note that multiple providers can be added to the same application. So if we attempt to add Facebook's and GitHub's providers in our application properties file and run the app, when we navigate to the Swagger endpoint, we will be redirected to an auto-generated page asking us to pick our preferred login method, Google, Facebook, or GitHub. Now, as a small representation of what is happening behind the scenes, consider the flow diagram we see. The first step, as we mentioned, is accessing Google's authorization server. The server will grant our application with an authorization code unique to it. This code can be used or exchanged for a token specific to that user. Now that token will be used to access the specific resources and actions tied to it. And finally, these resources and actions will be handed over to the user. Resources and actions can range from simply logging in, to browsing, to applying changes, editing the application, or invoking certain endpoints. Okay, you see, we already have a lot going on in our application, and all we did was add a Maven dependency and a few configuration lines. So it goes without saying that there is a lot we haven't covered yet. We barely scratched the surface. Also, please note that what we did today works only on Spring Boot applications. For non-boot apps, we will have to register to the provider and issue the client ID and client secrets manually in code. Let us know in the comments below if you'd like a part 2 video for this one, in which we dive into roles, permissions, and privileges. And that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.